Welcome, everyone. My name is Brendan Snyder. Thank you for joining me. Today, we are remembering Ken Hensley. He was a singer, songwriter, multi-instrumentalist, and producer, best known for his keyboard work with Uriah Heep. He has passed away November 4th, 2020, at the age of 75. Now, Ken Hensley first came to prominence in the late 1960s with his band, The Gods. They formed back in 1965 and featured Mick Taylor on guitar, who would go on to play with the Rolling Stones. And during that time, they featured a number of other prominent members that came through the ranks. There was Greg Lake on bass, later of King Crimson and ELP, John Glasscock also on bass at one time, later of Jethro Tull, and then Lee Kerslake on drums, later of Uriah Heep, bandmate with Ken Hensley, and also with Ozzy Osbourne and the Blizzard of Oz band. So pretty interesting the number of prominent people who came through that band as a stepping stone going on. And the band initially recorded two albums, Genesis in 1968 and To Samuel a Son in 1969. And the reason I say initially is because they did release another album under a pseudonym called Head Machine. The name of the band was Head Machine. And the album was called Orgasm. It came out in 1969. And then the band went through another change and evolved and developed into a group called Toe Fat, changing the name. And they released a self-titled album in 1970. Also in late 1969, actually December of that year, Ken Hensley was asked to join Uriah Heep by bassist Paul Newton. And along with Mick Box on guitar, vocalist David Byron on vocals, of course, Ken Hensley there, keyboards and guitars himself, and Alex Napier on drums, forming Uriah Heep at that point. And they did, in these formative early years, go through three different drummers before eventually Lee Kerslake comes in 1971, and you get that nice pairing there between the two. And during Ken's 10 years in Uriah Heep up until 1980, he recorded 13 studio albums with them and wrote a lot of their hit songs, including the album 1972's Demons and Wizards. This album here, it's one of my favorites of them and probably the most popular here in the U.S. It featured the number 39 Billboard Hot 100 Easy Living, and on the strength of that was ultimately certified gold for sales of 500,000 copies. Their next two albums in the U.S. did very well as also they were certified gold. And during this time, though, it was interesting, he found time to record two solo albums. But by 1980, he was getting a little unhappy with the band's direction and sound, and so he ultimately decided to leave. And at that point, he released his third solo album before joining Southern rockers Blackfoot in 1982. And with them, he recorded two albums. And the first one here, Siogo, I don't know if I'm saying that right, came out in 1983, but ultimately it was later revealed that that was an acronym. It's spelled S-I-O-G-O and stands for Suck It or Get Out. At the time it was said to have been an Indian word, but they later revealed it was just this acronym. Next, they released Vertical Smiles in 1984. You can see the sort of tongue-in-cheek to both names of those. If you've seen the album cover for Vertical Smiles, you'll know what I'm talking about. Look it up if you don't know it. All right, and then in 1985, upon hearing about the death of former Uriah Heep vocalist David Byron, he left Blackfoot and went into semi-retirement. He did make some occasional appearances with Cinderella, the hair band of the mid to late 80s, and then with heavy metal band Wasp even. But he remained in sort of semi-retirement throughout that into the 90s. But by about 1999, Ken began to slowly show more activity and increase what he was doing. And he ultimately released an album called A Glimpse of Glory. And then in 2007, he released one of my favorite albums of his, the rock opera, Blood on the Highway. This one here is kind of cool. It's a little bit of a limited edition, the way that the packaging was done on here, and opens up and so forth. Sometime I'll have to do a review and go through on that. But ultimately, this rock opera was about sort of what else? The rise and fall of a rock star. And it featured some really interesting guest vocalists on it. Glenn Hughes is on it, from Trapeze, Deep Purple, Black Sabbath, Black Country Communion, currently in the Dead Daisies. I mean, the list can go on for him. He's a fantastic, phenomenal singer. John Lawton, who was a former Uriah Heep vocalist, also guested on it, and Jorn Landy, who's a great powerhouse vocalist. If you don't know him, look him up. And Ken would continue to record new albums. He did this going forward with his current live band at the time, Live Fire. This album here, Faster, in 2012 is really great, and then Trouble in 2013. And the remaining years, he had not done much activity, but he had sort of remained in semi-retirement at that point. Ultimately, following a short illness, he passed away on November 4th of 2020 at the age of 75. In closing, though, his keyboard and sound and playing was admired by so many. I mean, you can look at the outpouring of love that has come for him in the time of his passing. He helped define an early proto-heavy metal sound. Rest in peace, Ken Hensley. Thank you for the immense catalog of work you left behind for everyone to enjoy. I'm really saddened by your loss. I will continue to celebrate and enjoy your legacy and all that you have left behind. All right, I hope you guys enjoyed this, and if you did, please leave your thoughts and comments. Let me know if you have any memories of Ken Hensley, Uriah Heep, one of his bands, maybe even going all the way back to the gods. Let me know. All right, I hope you guys enjoyed this. As I said, have a great day, take care, and we'll talk soon. Bye-bye.